My name is Barbara Kellerman, and I have come here, and I'm standing before you to welcome you formally, but also very informally, to the Kennedy School's third annual Conference on Leadership. This conference represents a coming of age of collective conversations on the subject. When the Center for Public Leadership opened its doors 3.5 years ago, it occurred to us that bringing people together around this subject, around leadership, a subject for so long at the margin of the modern academy, would be an important thing to do. But we could not know, did not know, if anyone else would share this view. So far as I'm concerned, it is to the credit of Ira Jackson, serving at the time as director of the Center for Business and Government, and to the credit of Mark Moore, serving then as he does now as the director of the Hauser Center for Nonprofit Organizations, that they were willing to take a flyer on this, to give the Center for Public Leadership legitimacy, to give leadership at the Kennedy School legitimacy by collaborating with the Center for Public Leadership in holding the first of these annual conferences. From the start, these conferences have been boundary crossers. They have crossed disciplinary divides. They have crossed the still rather rigid lines between the private sector, the public sector, the nonprofit sector, and the military sector. They have narrowed the split between scholars and practitioners. They have closed the gap among various stakeholders. We have invited deliberately to each of these conferences not only KSG faculty, but also faculty from other parts of the university and from outside the university, and some students and some alumni and some staff and some interested others who would not, under ordinary circumstances, be part of this conversation. This year, the boundary crossing is perhaps even more striking. In keeping with President Larry Summers's mandate for greater cross-university conversation, pollination, and fertilization, and in keeping with discussions about leadership that are taking place within and increasingly among every one of Harvard's professional schools as well as arts and sciences, this conference has on the program faculty from Harvard's Kennedy School and from the School of Education and from the Divinity School and from the Business School and from the Law School and from Arts and Sciences. This conference assumes the conversation that will take place over the next day and a half is just the start of a new era, or, depending on how you look at it, the return to an earlier era in which issues relating to power and authority and influence were considered central to the course of human affairs and, of course, to higher learning. An event such as this one is the product of many hands. In this case, none wove the rich tapestry that is this conference with more intelligence and care than Rod Kramer. Rod is one of us. That is, he is visiting professor of public management at the Kennedy School, and he is also, I regret to say, not one of us. His real home is far from here. He is William Kimball Professor of Organizational Behavior at the Stanford Graduate School of Business. While his professional accomplishments are as numerous as they are outstanding, and indeed you can find them in your conference packet, the real point that I would want to make about Rod is a personal one. He has been an absolutely splendid colleague. He has been, from the start, a wonderfully smart, responsible, and good-natured partner in this enterprise. Rod, you're a joy to work with, and I thank you.
Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
Thank you very much, Barbara. And good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's my great pleasure to welcome everyone to this conference, a conference that addresses what we think is a topic of great importance, the misuse of power in today's world. I suspect there is no one in this room who cannot provide his or her favorite, compelling, and dismaying example of misuse of power. There are, unfortunately, too many examples to choose from. We've seen leaders use hard power when they should have used soft power, and soft power might have carried them further. We've seen leaders use their power to pursue self-interest rather than collective interest. And we've seen leaders who simply won't let go, hanging on to power too long. Some of them work at Disney. We've witnessed corporations that have misused their enormous financial power, betraying the trust we've conferred on them. And we've seen many of our most revered and cherished institutions recently disappoint us, both by their actions, but also by their inactions. The purpose of this conference is to bring fresh perspective and insight to the multifaceted problem we're here to talk about today, and also to try to think of remedies or corrections for it. And to do so, we've brought together over the next day and a half an eclectic and truly breathtaking and exciting group of scholars and practitioners from all corners of the Harvard community. And until Barbara had mentioned the word, I was not sure if it's okay to say, and also from a few corners of the Stanford and USC communities throughout in California. In putting this event together, we wanted to be lively, we wanted to be fun, we wanted to be engaging, and we wanted to be collegial. We wanted to start new conversations, as Barbara mentioned, and also initiate new research collaborations. Importantly, we wanted to push thinking forward on this important topic and not merely present work that had already been finished. And in that spirit, we've asked the participants, in a way, to speak too briefly, far too briefly in fairness to them, but with the idea of sharing their most important thoughts, their most urgent thinking about this problem, with the understanding that we hope to follow this up with additional conferences at Harvard, and also that we will prepare an edited volume that will capture much of what we've learned here and accomplished here, and also perhaps even further volumes that will embellish on what we accomplish here today. So I look forward to the next day and a half. I certainly look forward to getting to know many of you in the room who I don't know very well yet. And let me turn over the events now to a person I have come to know since visiting here in fall of 2001, a person I've developed a tremendous respect and admiration for, Mark Moore. Now, I think everyone in this room knows Mark Moore better than I, but for those of you who don't know him, and if you glance at his autobiography in the package, you'll realize the impressive number of accomplishments, the impressive number of books. What I have found most impressive about Mark as a person is that when you get together with him and talk about anything, including the first days we talked about this conference, he's a man of infectious enthusiasm, great insight about institutions and how they work. He knows how to get things done, and he certainly helped make this happen today. So with that, Mark.
You're having to sit through a rather tedious display of people who are sponsoring this activity, and I apologize for that. But I am quite proud to be here participating in the sponsorship of this activity, the third annual conference on leadership. And one of the reasons I'm particularly proud of this, the reason that the Hauser Center is particularly proud about this, is for a reason that I think is important for us to know now and keep in mind throughout our conference as we go along. Many years ago, our current dean, Joe Nye, stood up in front of the faculty and delivered an important challenge to the Kennedy School faculty. He said that he believed that the world was changing in a way that would dramatically change both the sources and the forms of leadership that would be available for solving public problems. And he put in front of us a picture of a world in which leadership with respect to the solution of public problems came not just from the national government, not just even from state and local governments, but also from nonprofit world and from the business world. And even more importantly, he argued then that he suspected that the form that leadership would take would be not only that it would come from these different platforms or locations in the society, but that increasingly the way in which we both defined and accomplished the public's work would depend on networks that crossed the boundaries of these different sectors. And that if we were a school that was trying to train people for public leadership, we would have to train people who felt comfortable not only in standing on each of those particular platforms, but also in moving comfortably across the boundaries that were represented by that in the interest of mobilizing effective action to deal with problems. Now, I can't tell you that that challenge has been fully integrated into the Kennedy School's mind at this stage. And Joe's a visionary in many ways, as you'll hear from his talk on soft power. And this local challenge that he gave to us, we're still, I think, working our way through. But one of the important consequences of it is that it has forged an inevitable and important relationship between the Center for Public Leadership on the one hand, the Hauser Center on Nonprofit Organizations, the Center for Business and Government, and our faculty that works on both public management and political advocacy at the Kennedy School, because those are the people who are going to have to, in the end, respond effectively to the Dean's challenge. And I'm proud to be part of that responsibility. The nonprofit sector is going to show up then as an important source of leadership. But one of the things that's most interesting about these cross-boundary partnerships, I think, that we're going to have to keep in mind is that oftentimes boundary spanning creates very interesting ethical challenges, right? It's not at all clear when a government makes an arrangement with a private party to, for example, clean up a park, all right, whether we have, in fact, improved the total capacity to deliver on a public benefit, or whether we've delivered a piece of publicly valuable property to a private individual for their own particular purpose. Many things that we would call public-private partnerships today and praise would have been viewed as corruption about 30 years ago, right? So we have to sort of keep that roughly in mind. Similarly, we see nonprofit organizations forming important relationships with for-profit organizations around such things as cause marketing, for example. And again, at the outset, those deals look as though they are very attractive deals in which both sides can benefit substantially. And yet on close examination, sometimes it turns out that there's an important question about who got the most out of the deal, right? And was the deal fairly structured in terms of the way in which it took advantage of the assets of the different organizations and the way in which it delivered the benefits then of that collaboration? So as we turn to our attention to the subject of partnerships, the questions about what constitute abuses of position and power, I think, are going to turn out to be more complicated, not less. There's a kind of poise that will be required as we bring our assets that we represent into contact with one another and find ways to combine their forces for achieving a variety of purposes that, that we'll have to attend to decide whether we like them or not. In any case, in this task, I'm not only grateful to have my colleague Joe Nye set this challenge in front of us, but I'm also very grateful to my other colleague and partner in this enterprise, David Gergen. And again, it's customary, as you know, in introducing your fellow academics to list their titles and long accomplishments and stuff like that. But I don't actually know any about that thing about that, about David, all right? I'm a very local parochial guy. And the only thing I know about David is that he not only is extremely astute analyst of leadership, not only enormously skillful in giving advice to leaders, but most importantly, from my point of view, he's important in bringing leadership to the Kennedy School. So I'm very grateful to have the Center for Public Leadership here leading the way of the Kennedy School towards an improved capacity to create leaders for a democratic society. So my colleague, Dave Gergen.
Thank you, Mark. And I must say that the collaboration between the Hauser Center and the Center for Public Leadership and our collaboration with you personally and with Sean, who was there for so long, have been among the happiest experiences that we've had at the Kennedy School. And we hope that they're part of a growing trend, this whole notion. We have so many centers. Alex is smiling broadly. We have so many centers that, had it been so separate and to bring them together more, to work together more, I think is something that's benefited all of us. And we certainly have benefited richly from our association with the Hauser Center. I also want to take a moment in advance to say thank you to both Barbara Kellerman and to Rod Kramer for organizing this. They are the architects. Barbara Kellerman deserves enormous praise for this whole idea of these annual leadership conferences was Barbara's. And way back when, some 3 years ago, she took the lead. She went out and worked with Mark. She went out and worked with others to produce the first. And now here we're at our third. They continue to deepen an intellectual strength. This is by invitation only, and so we're so pleased that so many of you are here, and we thank you for coming. But I do want to thank you, Barbara, for bringing this together. She does it very quietly, and she takes a very this is not entirely characteristic of Barbara. She takes a very low-key role in these proceedings. but believe me, she has a lot to offer. And Rod Kramer, as you come here as a visiting professor, we can only express our dream that one day we can strike the word visiting. but we are thankful, sir, that you've come from Stanford, and of course you're joined by Deborah Rohde to your left from Stanford, who is no stranger as well, who's familiar to many of you. As we begin these proceedings, I might say just a word about the end of the proceedings. You'll probably next hear from me if you are so inclined. We would love to have you join us tomorrow night at my home for a reception. As this concludes, it'll be early in the evening. My wife, Ann, is unable to join us, so I'm very happy to that Betsy Myers, our new executive director at the Center for Public Leadership, has agreed to co-host that event, and she'll bring some class to the hosting. That will be very helpful, so we'll look forward to that as well. Now, to the business at hand. We thought at the center that, and I might just say one more word about this leadership thing, about the way it's just about where we are. It's difficult for those who have been with the center for these past 3 years to appreciate just how fast things have built up since then. And I know Ron Heifetz, who has been the pioneer here for so many years and has been so successful in the classroom with the whole generation of students now. We were talking the other day just how almost surprised we are that the interest level has grown in this subject and trying to develop scholarship and trying to develop courses, that we're now engaged in serious conversations about a cross-university initiative that would bring together the business school, the Kennedy School, and the other professional schools, possibly in the context of the Alston development. And Joe Nye has been right in the center of those conversations. But it's with that in mind, in part, that we thought it might be most productive if this conference began with a presentation by Joe Nye. Why? Two reasons. One, he was the visionary that thought there ought to be more concentration on leadership here at the Kennedy School. He was the one who drafted people, got people together, started making things happen, and lo and behold, produced this center. Without him, we would not be here today. And we thought as he completed his deanship, it would be appropriate to thank him and to celebrate his leadership in creating this whole enterprise. Beyond that, there's a second reason that's very equally important, and that is what I think is several of us who've been in this field have been so pleased and encouraged by is that Joe has not just taken an interest in trying to deepen the school's understanding of leadership, but his own intellectual journey has increasingly taken him into the field of leadership studies. He's someone who has always been, of course, a scholar and a renowned scholar in international relations, and increasingly he's thinking about the question of leadership within the context of international relations, and that we find enormously just energizing. And he is just publishing a book entitled Soft Power, and as you hear that title, you will quickly recognize that he is one of the few scholars at the university who has coined a phrase that has actually sort of lived on well beyond the sound bites and is almost associated with his name. You think about that, and you think about who else in the university now in social sciences? Well, Sam Huntington. Clash of Civilizations, you automatically think Sam Huntington. The whole notion of clusters and economic development, you think about Michael Porter. Well, this whole notion of power and its uses, especially the notion of soft power, is the one that Joe began developing some years ago. It's not the corpus of his work. His work is much, much broader. And indeed, we're all looking forward to the novel that he is bringing out. They're bringing out later in the year. John Deutsch has already been previewing the sex scenes in the novel. he's vowed a private reading for all of those who wish to come. But nonetheless, that Joe has really deepened all of our understandings and changed the conversation about how we think about power and the uses of power. And so it's with enormous gratitude as well as pride that I introduce to you the dean of our school, Joe Nye.
Thank you, David, for that unduly generous introduction. When David and Barbara suggested I might talk about soft power today, I said, well, there are two problems. One is that it's always risky to invite a dean to do anything in academia, because deans are well known for letting their brains go into jelly as they take on administrative tasks. And there's that famous story, which some of you may have heard a few times before, which is, once upon a time, there was a dean who was so divorced from scholarship and so out of touch with what was going on that even the other deans began to notice. And the other caution that I gave David was not just a generic one about being dean, but that to talk about soft power and leadership was a work in progress. I coined the term soft power and tried to develop the concept in a book I wrote in 1990 about the relationship of the United States and the world and why I thought the United States was not in decline. It has taken on a certain currency. But I was thinking of it primarily in the international context. So a lot of my examples and illustrations come from my own work in foreign policy and international politics. I haven't done a lot of thinking about soft power and leadership. And I intend to after I retire on June 30th. As you may know, I get a year off for good behavior. And at that point, I will start to try to think about this. But before that, it's a work in progress. You'll find too many illustrations from my past work and not about what I intend to do in the future. So I apologize for that at the beginning. On the other hand, there is an interesting connection between soft power and leadership, which I do intend to tease out when I have time to think. And basically, if you define leadership as the dictionary does in as going ahead or showing the way or helping a group to define and achieve a common purpose, there are obviously very many types and levels of leadership. But what they have in common is a relationship with followers. And because of that, leadership is inextricably intertwined with power. And that means that a number of leadership skills, such as creating vision, communicating it, attracting and choosing able people, forming coalitions, depend very much on soft power. But I'll come back to this. But first of all, what I want to do is address the question of what is power. If you think of power as the ability to influence others to get the outcomes you want, there are essentially three ways of doing it, to somewhat oversimplify. You can threaten people with coercion. You can pay people or induce them or bribe them, and you can attract them. And those are three quite different ways of influencing people to get the outcomes you want. Basically, the third of those is the one that I want to focus on, the ability to attract and co-opt people rather than threaten and coerce or bribe or pay. And we're all familiar with this. I mean, it's common sense in a way. I mean, a loyal Catholic who decides to follow the Pope's teaching on capital punishment will do so perhaps because of a threat of excommunication, but maybe because of a belief in the authority or in the legitimacy of the Pope. And some radical Muslims who might follow bin Laden and do his will, might do so not because of payments or threats, but because they believe in the legitimacy of his objectives. So quite clearly, that ability to attract or co-opt is with us every day. Now, if you think of power the way I've defined it so far, or used it so far, it's a behavioral terminology. But there's another way of approaching power, which is in terms of resources. That is to say that sometimes it's hard to know people's motivations. And so there's a shortcut that people often use, which is to say, well, we think of power in ways that are more concrete and measurable by looking at resources. So in my own field, the resources that can influence outcomes are things like the size of your population and territory and military and economy and so forth. And that's the standard way to measure the power of nations, which is to tote up these different sets of resources. And it's nice to be able to have something as concrete as that, as opposed to these behavioral definitions that I started with. But there are certain problems with that measurement form of approaching power. It's true that you want to know who holds the high cards in any card game, but there is a paradox that sometimes those best endowed with power resources are not able to produce the outcomes that they want. And it's important then to realize that power is not as fungible as money. It is indeed something that we talk about all the time in political science and sociology and so forth, but it's not fungible in many circumstances. What one wins in one card game may not win another. A winning poker hand doesn't help an awful lot if the game is bridge. And even if the game is poker, and you have a wonderful hand, and you display at least some of the cards, you may be able to bluff other people out of the game. On the other hand, you may fall victim to bluff yourself, or you may play your hand poorly. So having the power resources does not guarantee power outcomes. As the United States found out in Vietnam, or as the world's only superpower found out on September 11th. And leaders often make misjudgments, as Saddam Hussein illustrated twice within a decade, and as Hitler and others, Stalin, had done earlier. So measuring power in terms of resources is an imperfect, even if useful, shorthand. And as a first approximation in any game, it helps to know who has the high cards, but it's not sufficient. And you really do have to take the context into account. Oil, for example, was not an impressive power resource before the Industrial Age. It was a nasty pollutant. Uranium was not a significant power resource before the nuclear age. So context matters tremendously in terms of judging power. Before you can judge who's holding the high cards in any card game, you have to understand what game you're playing, the value of the cards, and how they may be changing, and in some situations, how those who hold the cards may play their hands poorly and not win the game. After all, those who have the endowed resources of high office, command of force, or a lot of wealth do not always win and are not always those who are thus most powerful in behavioral terms. That's what revolutions are all about. Let me turn now to soft power. Everybody's familiar with hard power. It's easy to understand or to feel. We know how military and economic might can get others to change their positions. And hard power can rest on inducements, carrots, or on threats, sticks. But when we turn to soft power, it means getting others to want the outcomes you want, to co-opt people rather than coerce them. And that soft power rests very much on the ability to shape the preferences of others. At the personal level, we're all familiar with this, with the power of attraction and seduction on a daily level. In a marriage, at least in mine, power does not necessarily rest with a larger partner. And if one looks in the business world, one realizes that smart executives understand that leadership is not just a matter of issuing commands, but also involves leading by example and attracting others to do what you want. It's very difficult to run any large organization, whether a business or a nonprofit or indeed a university or a school, without being able to get others to buy into your values. And I think that's an interesting illustration of the role that soft power plays in organization theory. It also plays a role in broader policy issues. Mark Moore pointed out to me at one point that the whole practice of community-based policing relies on making the police sufficiently friendly and attractive that a community wants to help them in achieving shared objectives. Political leaders have long understood that power that comes from attraction. If I can get you to want what I want, then I don't have to spend so many carrots and sticks to make you do it. And for leaders in authoritarian countries, coercion and command is often available as a power resource. But for leaders in democracies, they really have to rely much more on a combination of inducement and attraction. Soft power is thus a staple of daily democratic politics. And the ability to establish preferences tends to be associated with such intangible assets as attractive personality, culture, political values and institutions, and policies that are seen as having legitimacy or moral authority. If a leader represents values that others want to follow, it costs less to lead. Soft power is not merely the same as influence. After all, influence can also rest on hard power of threats or payments. Soft power is more than just persuasion or the ability to move people by argument, though that's an important part of it. It's also the ability to attract, and attraction often leads to acquiescence. Or simply put, in behavioral terms, soft power is attractive power. In terms of resources, the second type of definition of power, soft power resources are the assets that produce that attraction. And whether a particular asset is a soft power resource or not can be measured by asking people through polls or focus groups. It's not all ephemeral. And whether that attraction in turn produces desired policy outcomes has to be judged in particular cases. Attraction does not always determine others' preferences. But the gap between power measured as a resource and power judged in terms of outcomes of behavior, that gap is not unique to soft power. It occurs with all forms of power. Tanks are an important hard power resource, but they may not produce hard power behavior if they're used in swamps and jungles. So if you think about soft power, then you have to say that if you can persuade somebody to go along with your purposes without any explicit threat or exchange taking place, in short, if my behavior is determined by an observable but intangible attraction, it's likely that soft power is at work. Or another way of thinking of it, soft power uses a different type of currency, not force, not money, to engender cooperation, an attraction to shared values and justness and duty of contributing to the achievement of those values. And if leadership is then seen as legitimate in the eyes of others, it's likely to encounter less resistance. And if culture and values are attractive, others are more likely to and willingly follow. If a government or a corporation or an organization establishes or follows rules that are consistent with the interests of others, its actions will be more likely to be legitimate in their eyes. And if it can support and create, if a leader can support and create institutions that encourage others to channel or limit their activities in ways that it prefers, it will not need as many costly carrots or sticks. Much as Adam Smith observed that people are led by an invisible hand when making decisions in a free market, our decisions in the marketplace for ideas are often shaped by soft power, an intangible attraction that persuades us to go along with others without any explicit threat or exchange taking place. Let me say a little bit about the interplay between hard and soft power. Hard power and soft power are related because they're both aspects of the ability to achieve one's purpose by affecting the behavior of others. And the distinction between them is one of degree, both in the nature of the behavior and in the tangibility of the resources that are involved. Command power, the ability to change what others do, can rest on coercion or inducement. Cooperative power, the ability to shape what others want, can rest on the attractiveness of one's culture and values or the ability to manipulate the agenda of political choices in a manner that makes others fail to express some preferences because they seem too unrealistic. The types of behavior that in between command at one end of a spectrum and co-option at the other end of the spectrum range from coercion to economic inducement to agenda setting to pure attraction. And soft power resources tend to be associated with the cooperative end of the spectrum, whereas hard power resources are usually associated with command behavior. But the relationship is imperfect. For example, sometimes people are attracted to others with command power by myths of invincibility. As Osama bin Laden put it in one of those famous videos, when people see a strong horse and a weak horse, by nature they will back the strong horse. And in that sense, we don't want to make the mistake of thinking that hard and soft power are totally divorced from each other. They sometimes reinforce and sometimes interfere with each other. A leader who courts popularity may be loath to exercise hard power when he should, but a leader who throws his weight around without regard to the effects on its soft power may find others placing obstacles in the way of its hard power. If you think back a year ago now to the case of Turkey in the Gulf War, it's an interesting example. The United States wanted to move the 4th Infantry Division across Turkey to enter Iraq from the north, so we could have gotten to the Sunni Triangle sooner. Because the Americans had lost attractiveness or popularity in Turkey, and Turkey now had a more effective parliament, we couldn't get that permission. And that meant the 4th Infantry Division had to go through the canal, up through the Gulf, and was late to the party. That's a clear case where inadequate attention to our soft power deliberately or directly undercut our hard power. Sometimes the same power resources can affect the entire spectrum of behavior from coercion to attraction. In many real-world situations, people's motives are mixed. Moreover, the distinction between hard and soft power is one of degree, both in the nature of the behavior and the tangibility of the resources. Both are aspects of the ability to achieve one's purposes by affecting the behavior of others. Let me say now a little bit about the limits of soft power. Some skeptics object to the idea of soft power because they think of power narrowly in terms of command or active control. Some people, in fact, even define power in terms of command and active control. In their view, attraction does not add up to power. Some attraction may produce some policy outcomes, but it is not sufficient. You have to be able to command and control. The trouble with these people, I think, is that they define away some of the most interesting aspects of power behavior. So as a semantic problem, if you take that type of definition, that power is command and control, you can define soft power out of existence, but you're going to miss an awful lot of interesting behavior of how you get others to do what you want. And that approach essentially ignores the second or structural face of power, the ability to get the outcomes you want without having to force people to change their behavior. At the same time that you don't want to write soft power out by definition, it is important to realize that there are conditions under which attraction is more likely to lead to desired outcomes and those where it will not. As I said earlier, all power depends on context, who relates to whom, under what circumstances. But soft power depends more than hard power upon the existence of willing interpreters and receivers. Moreover, attraction often has a diffuse effect of creating general influence rather than producing an easily observable specific action. And just as money can be invested, politicians speak of storing up political capital to be drawn upon in future circumstances. Of course, such goodwill may not ultimately be honored, and diffuse reciprocity of that sort is less tangible than an immediate exchange. Nonetheless, the indirect effects of attraction and of diffuse influence can make a significant difference in obtaining favorable outcomes in bargaining situations. Otherwise, leaders would insist only on immediate payoffs and specific reciprocity, and we know that's not the way they behave. Social psychologists have developed a substantial body of empirical research exploring the relationship between attractiveness and power. Soft power, though, is more likely to be important when power is dispersed. A dictatorial leader who is not responsive to the people under his rule, or not to a high degree, may be able to ignore popularity when he calculates his interests. But a democratic leader has far fewer degrees of freedom. Thus, it was easier to get permission to use bases in Uzbekistan than in Turkey. And finally, while soft power sometimes has direct effects on specific goals, it's more likely to have an impact on general goals, what are sometimes called milieu goals rather than specific possessions. For example, it's easier to attract people to democracy than to coerce them to be democratic. Both specific and general goals are important, but soft power is particularly relevant to the latter. The fact that the impact of attraction on achieving preferred outcomes varies by the context and type of goal does not make it irrelevant any more than the fact that bombs and bayonets do not produce desired outcomes when we seek to prevent the spread of infectious diseases or slow global warming or create democracy. So there are limits to soft power, but because there are limits does not mean that it's irrelevant and we can retreat to the definition of power as simply active command and control. Let me say a few words before concluding about the impact of the information revolution and the changes that that has wrought up. Since I've argued that context is so important, this is a significant change in context of power. The conditions for projecting soft power have transformed dramatically because of the information revolution. The information revolution creates virtual communities and networks that cut across national borders. Transnational corporations and non-governmental actors will play larger roles. Many of these organizations will have soft power of their own as they attract citizens into coalitions that cut across national boundaries. Political leadership then becomes, in part, a competition for attractiveness, legitimacy, and credibility across boundaries, not merely within a well-bounded political system. The ability to share information and to be believed becomes an important source of attraction and power. This political game in an information age suggests that the relative role of soft power to hard power is likely to increase. The most likely gainers in an information age are those who have multiple channels of communication that help to frame an issue, those with cultural customs and ideas and values that are close to prevailing global norms, and those with credibility that's enhanced by values and policy. Soft power resources are difficult to control. Indeed, a government that tries too hard to control them may actually damage its credibility. Soft power is difficult because of many of its crucial resources are outside the government, and their effects depend heavily on acceptance by receiving audiences. Moreover, soft power resources are often working indirectly by shaping the environment for policy, and it sometimes takes years to produce the desired outcomes. Of course, these differences are matters of degree. Not all hard power actions produce prompt outcomes either. Witness the length and ultimate failure of the Vietnam War, or the fact that economic sanctions have historically failed to produce their intended outcomes in more than half the cases where they've been tried. In Iraq, Saddam Hussein survived sanctions for more than a decade. But as one former military officer has put it, the mark of a great military campaign is not what it destroys, but what it creates. And sometimes dissemination of information can quickly produce or prevent a desired outcome. Generally, soft power resources are slower, more diffuse, and more cumbersome to wield than hard power resources, but not always. Information is power, as we all know, and today a much larger portion of the world's population has access to that power. Technological advances have led to dramatic reduction in the costs of processing and transmitting information. The result is an explosion of information that's produced what I call a paradox of plenty. When you have a surplus of information, then the scarce resource becomes attention. And the people who are overwhelmed by the volume of information confronting them have to know what to focus on, where to spend their attention. So if attention rather than information becomes the scarce resource, those who can distinguish valuable information from background clutter gain power. Editors and cue givers become more in demand, and this is a source of power for those who can tell us where to focus our attention. Among editors and cue givers, credibility is the credible resource and an important source of soft power. Reputation becomes even more important than in the past, and political struggles occur over the creation and destruction of credibility. Politics then becomes a contest of competitive credibility. The world of traditional power politics is typically about those whose military or economy wins. But politics in an information age may ultimately be about whose story wins. Governments compete with each other and with other organizations to enhance their own credibility and to weaken that of their opponents. Reputation has obviously always mattered in political leadership, but the role of credibility becomes an even more important power resource because of the paradox of plenty. Information that appears to be propaganda may not only be scorned, but may actually turn out to be counterproductive. Therefore, it's a mistake to discount soft power as just a question of image, public relations, and ephemeral popularity. It's a form of power, a means of obtaining desired outcomes. Finally, power in the information age will come not just from strong hard power, but from strong sharing. In an information age, such sharing not only enhances the abilities of others to cooperate with us, but also increases their inclination to do so. As we share with others, we develop common outlooks and approaches that improve our ability to deal with the new challenges. Power then becomes a positive sum rather than a zero-sum game. Power flows from that attraction. And dismissing the importance of attraction as merely ephemeral popularity ignores key insights from the new theories of leadership, as well as the new realities of the information age. So in conclusion, let me say that soft power has always been a key element of leadership. The power to attract, to get others to want what you want, to frame issues and to set the agenda, has deep roots in thousands of years of human experience. After all, in the book of Genesis, Joseph found himself imprisoned in Egypt, a foreign land, but he won the Pharaoh's favor through the attractiveness of his wisdom. Skillful leaders have always understood that attractiveness stems from credibility and legitimacy. Power has never flowed solely from the barrel of a gun. Even the most brutal dictators have relied on attraction as well as fear. Globalization and the communications revolution pose new leadership challenges that will increase the importance of credibility, legitimacy, and accountability. In an age when it's necessary to win the battle of the story, as well as the battle on the field, leaders need to pay more attention than ever, to soft power. When the United States paid insufficient attention to the issues of legitimacy and credibility in the way it went about its policy on Iraq, polls showed a very dramatic drop in American soft power over the last year. And essentially, that dramatic drop in American soft power did not prevent the United States from entering Iraq, but it meant that the United States had to pay much higher costs in terms of blood and treasure than it would otherwise have been the case. Similarly, if Yasser Arafat had chosen the soft power model of Gandhi or Martin Luther King rather than the hard power of terrorism, he could have attracted moderate Israelis and would probably have a Palestinian state by now. I said at the beginning that leadership is inextricably intertwined with power. Leaders have to make crucial choices about the types of power they use. And woe be to followers of those leaders who ignore or devalue the significance of soft power. Thank you.